medicine women reveal?
Signs. Clues. Information.
Interpreting life and dreams.
Medicine women reveal.
Revealing.
Our soul's truth.
Your life is not just an accident. Your soul is bringing in realities you can't see.
Are you paying attention to the signs, such as
financial burdens,
relationship dramas,
health issues, not just aches and pains, but stress, anxiety, depression?
Do you have a desire to find your life purpose?
Do you want more meaning in your life?
Do you want better than what you have now?
You may be lost in what you feel, but we can help you.
We are here to offer empowerment through enlightenment.
We are here to help you process life issues instead of just coping.
Medicine women reveal. Use science, spirituality, and healing tools to help people make sense of their world. They help connect the dots and solve the mysteries. They give direction so people can take ownership of their lives. And now I present Medicine Women Reveal with your solo coaches, Brenda Bates and Jen Toffel.
Brenda Bates, Medicine Woman, and with me is
Jen Toffel, Medicine Woman.
And we have a jam-packed show. There's a lot of things we're going to be doing. I'm in the middle of a path switch, and which meant...
Again.
Yes, again. And it's when I'm consciously choosing to participate with what my soul is projecting, working with the universe, helping myself understand the law of attraction. So this is part of okay, I do this once a week class called Empowerment Through Enlightenment, and all of a sudden it's like, I think I'm supposed to let it go. And I wasn't quite clear. I kept asking the questions, pull out my cards, what am I supposed to do? And it's the same kind of similar path switch like I had with my friend, as I was telling you that when I would go to Perry and I would, once a month, I would have the healing, the tools, and we would work on each other. We would learn about things. We would just have fun once a month. Mm-hmm. And I did that for about 7 years, and Spirit told me, this is before I really learned what past switch was about, you need to go and stop coming here. And I'm like, what? No. Well, a lot of you have heard the story that by the third time of going, I'll just go back one more time, our relationship started to deteriorate because I was choosing to go with my feeling. But, it feels right that I'm supposed to be doing this. Even though in a higher spiritual part of me was not to come here. Even though I didn't have the first certainty of why or the explanation of why not to go there. Finally I said, okay, yes, why is this happening? Why my friend and I seems to be falling apart? And the universe spoke and said, hey, your soul is on a path and it needs to pass switch and you need to go over here. If you do not bow out gracefully, then you know, the first time you heard it, the second time, third to a bee stink to up to a bitch slap, so you could ruin your friendship forever. I said, I don't want that. Well, what do you want to do? Well, if I don't want to ruin the relationship, that means that I'm going to start paying attention to the direction. And it was like basically when I finally made that choice of surrendering to that part of my soul's path, knowing that I'm going to become better than what I am, I said, all right. And like a matter of maybe a day or two, the answer was, there. Immediately the energy had said, we're switching, and yes, the better direction. Because everything's rearranged, now we can go in that direction. And then lo and behold, I got my next clue of where I'm supposed to go, and then I went down to Detroit for 8 months. Then I was done there. Then I went into becoming a teacher. And now that has been 8 years, and all of a sudden it's like, okay, you're going to not be done forever with empowerment through enlightenment, but we need to get you your energy off of that and to go into the next direction. The moment I said, okay, class has been canceled until further notice, so what are we going to do from here? And then it was like immediately the energy started rushing in. Well, we're going to start doing interviews next week. We have somebody lined up. She's a medium, and her name is
Karina.
And we can't say the last name until we get the phonetic spelling, because it is a very interesting way of saying it, and I don't want to ruin and butcher her name. But she is a medium, and so I'm very excited that we're going to start doing interviews on Fridays from 5 to 7. Now, sometimes I started to offer it maybe on Mondays. I was going to see, give and take, and play with it, because it is a learning curve of what's the best day. But for now, our first interview will be next week. So, then what came up to pass is that me and Jen have another radio show that we've put our name to. And are backing this. We're going to start doing it, other little things to help ourselves, to launch ourselves in the radio career, and doing platforms, helping everybody to go in the direction they need to be of service. And so we're excited that we're able to be on Sepia, and we're very thankful that it's a great family here.
And it's a great opportunity.
A great opportunity. Mark found us and asked us to come along, and I said, do we fit? He said, sure you do. And it's such a wonderful, diverse group. Again, I always refer to it as a painter's palette. All the different colors are on the palette, and they can blend together the way they need to.
Yep.
So I really enjoy it. Again, what an opportunity. So we are looking for, or Mark is, and Eric is, for producers and that can help out, and it's a volunteer basis, but it's, if you're learning to get the stepping stones going in your career, this is great, because this is like a great family to work with. They're supportive, they have your back, they're
too. Always helpful. They don't,
I swear, Mark's awake all the time. It's like me. They're not,
but yeah, they're very, it's a nurturing way to learn this endeavor.
Mm-hmm. So contributions are great, but if you want to be a part of the family, then we are looking for producers. And if you have a show in mind, and
right,
you
if you want to be a host of a show,
yeah, then you, or if you want to be interviewed, you know, you can contact us. We'll get a hold of Mark, and we'll make sure that all of the channels get going correctly. But anyways, there's no sense of stepping backwards. Let's step forward. So with my past switch, I'm all excited about that. Now, I'm always intrigued about my spiritual leadership of what I'm supposed to do. And so things will pop up and be in my face so that I can address them to the best way possible. Because being the spiritual leader that I'm becoming is helping you to become a spiritual human. Meaning the old ways of thinking, the old ways of acting, the old personalities, the old templates of that archetypes, we're changing out, and we're moving the energy to a higher vibration. And this meme came across my page. It says, the universe is not punishing you or blessing you. The universe is responding to the vibrational attitude that you are emitting. And I believe in that, and because that is how I look and, you know, at the universe. Like, I could feel that the past switch, and I was emitting a frequency from my soul that was really allowing me to say, hey, you can participate, or you can see as a bitch slap, which way you want it. So, again, it's quite interesting when I see these things. I swear to God, I'm going to make a meme book, you know. The answer this one person wrote, I'm calling bullshit on this. I was the most positive person and the happiest person that I knew. But guess what? The universe responded by allowing the energy vampires to see my light and radiate energy, and they sucked it out of me. I have learned that it is way better to be just ho-hum happy, because then you are off the radar. This happened over and over and over until I finally realized that it was a planet, that this planet is a lie. Stupid quotes like this just make people blame themselves for not having, being, living, whatever they want. In all actuality, we control very little that happened to us. If this stupid quote were true, then I would still be the happiest, most positive person I knew, because the universe would have responded the same. Perhaps the universe does not like happy people and responds with destruction. Now, that's very negative.
I have a lot of responses in my head.
Well, let's get cracking on them.
Okay. So the first thing, because you said that you wanted me to bring Swedenborg to the table. So here
yes.
we go. We're bringing Emanuel Swedenborg to the table on this one. As far as what you're admitting, in the theology that I follow, the idea is that in order for us to grow, we are always being invited to be that spiritual person. We have our natural self and we have our spiritual self. Natural self is this human, you know, I'm interacting with the world. Pokey pokey, yes, I'm in this meat suit. Spiritual self, we have a soul. We have this spirit that's alive within us. When we die, our material body falls to the wayside. Our spirit lives on. The point is for us to develop be all that you can be. Be the best spiritual person. Wake up to that spiritual life. And in order for that to happen, Swedenborg says that we encounter what's called temptations. Now, temptations invite us to grow. It's not a test from the universe. God is not punishing us. God is not testing us. Because all our temptations are different. I have different spiritual temptations than you're going to have based on how you grew up, based on how I grew up. And so my temptation, you know, I could write a book on that. But it's facing those. Okay, I'm being tempted. The biggest temptation for me is to just sit on my ass and do nothing. Wouldn't that be great if I could just be a lump on a log and go not have to do anything? That's the biggest temptation. Oh my gosh, it feels so good just to sit and do nothing. But that's not my purpose. That's not my spiritual calling. That's not my vocation. That's not what I was put on the planet to do. That's not the use that I have for being here. I need to answer that calling. So that's something that I encounter. Oh, do I just want to sit, or should I go do something? What do I want? But I'm in that wrestling from moment to moment, from day to day, from week to week, and so on and so on. So I'm being invited to wake up to that spiritual person and say, nah, I'm not going to sit and do nothing because I got things to be doing. Okay, so I was tempted. Yeah, I'm gonna answer this. So it's not this test. It's not this punish. But I have to be responsible for my life. I am the one living as Gentile.
That's true. That is very, very true. That's very true. So, you know, I'm looking at this part of paying attention to, you know, the reason that she's crying the bullshit is because all the way she knows it. This is so important. My dissertation is all about how does an individual know it. It is her identity that, yes, I have proof that these people did it to me. That's how she knows it. That's the energy she's emitting. That is what she's got to prove herself to be saved, so she has to prove it. And there it is. See, there's proof, and so I told you so. And so, yes, that was the thing that threw me off center, and because there was no way to process that moment, you repeat. You're actually sitting there repeating until you break that pattern, and wait a minute, so it did happen. Well, let me take my energy off it because I am done. And a lot of times, we never taught how to process. Now, if we look a little bit further, she learned to live and learn. This is huge. Live and learn. And that means that you lived a moment, and what'd you learn from it? Well, some people think that they have to compromise. They have to cut themselves up and fit. Well, she says she has to go ho-hum, because if she's off the radar, then she won't be seen by the boogeyman. Well, first of all, if you're radiating enough light, and it's just not about being happy, but radiating enough vibration throughout your 41 thoughts per minute you have, and radiating that in the subconscious level, then the dark can't touch you because the frequencies can't match. Go take your frequency of who you are, stick it in the light socket, and if you match, then you'll be vibrating just fine. But if you don't, you might just get shocked. And that's exactly what happens in the world, is you get shocked. You're happy, you get thrown off your center, and all of a sudden you're shocked, and I can't even process this moment. Well, guess what? We need to stop showing how you know it. We need to just take your energy off, the emotions off, all the proof, file it away. It isn't about denying it. It's about cleaning up the damn countertop so you can live life a little bit more. What else do we have here? It says that we are blaming ourselves. Here's the thing. No, it's not. It's called the cause and effect of who you are in, because you're the observer of this physical meat suit.
What's the common denominator? Oh, I'm in each situation. Maybe I want to take a look at that. Mm-hmm. But I'm not blaming myself, and I'm not condemning myself for doing whatever. It's, wow, a common denominator is, wow, I seem to be in all these situations. Wow, maybe I should take a look at this.
And the only way that you would blame yourself, if you have an emotional loss, if the energy is tied to it, attached to it, defined, and you have the great experience of, oh my God, in it, that just means, now again, watch, you're on your center, you're happy to be, you get knocked off, oh my God, you're in shock, you can't process, and all you're telling your soul is that I'm going to mark this, and I'm going to come back later, like a bookmark in a book. You're going to come back, and you're going to finish a chapter of the book eventually. But we never get to, because we don't have the next stage of our knowledge to do so. Why? Because every time that the soul brings it up and says, oh, here's the issue you had, can you look and heal it now? What do?
Maybe.
We react the exact same way as we did the very first time. Unless you are learning to awaken and be able to see both sides, use healing tools, and that's what Jen and I are here to show people, is the healing tools, that you can take them when the next time the shit hits to the fan or the floaters come to the surface, you don't have to go and respond the same way. Ah! You're responding the same way because you're showing yourself how much energy loss and how much you believe and how much you know.
You
so
can
it's
actually
important.
Turn off the fan so it's not such a mess.
Exactly. Yeah, turn off the fan so it's not such a mess. Very good. I like that. And so then you get to file it away. You actually get to flush the toilet. You actually let it go. You don't need to keep that crap anymore. And it's not about denying, it's not about pep talking, it's not about any of those things. It's literally about evolving. And so I say resolve to evolve or heal instead of deal. And heal, people say, well, I have healed that. Yeah, how many old-fashioned ways have you had it, and why does it still come to the surface? Because if you healed it, you wouldn't see it. It would actually literally be filed away. And seeing some people say, well, I've healed it, I don't see it. No, but all your friends do. So there's another way to look at it, because you've numbed yourself so much at it that you don't even know you're doing it.
And all your friends are like, yeah, we knew you did that. Oh, great, could you... you want to clue me in next time?
And to blame, that's all this person is doing, is blaming. You did it to me. You did it to me. And when you're looking out here and you did it to me, what's happening is that you, as a spirit that's animating this physical being... And you look through your ego, electromagnetic guiding omni-apparition, meaning that it's come to life. As you look at it, that's fine. You can identify a table. This is a person. This is the color purple. This is hair. But when you over-identify is when, why you got red hair? I hate red hair people. You know, or I got it. Oh, you, it's your fault that you're wearing red and now I'm mad. It's your fault. I mean, literally, that's an over-identification process. That is
and then
you.
The rebel in me is like,
come on, bitch, bring it on. Yeah.
Let's go.
But literally, this is what happens. And this is the process that we are learning to grow out of. We're coming into a new world, and I'm giving you new tools to be able to live in this new world. And you're becoming a spiritual human. Meaning that your humanistic side of you doesn't have to be in charge first. It is your true identity, which is the spirit part of you, because you're the essence, you're the thumbprint. And that is you. You're becoming first. So that means that you go to your higher self for the wisdom first instead of going to your go-to box, which is your over-identification. And then eventually go and say, God, why didn't you help me? You know, that one always gets me. I could rant. But anyways, we're going to take a small break and we'll be right back. Like I said with the past, which is an incredible thing, we have decided to move the store that was behind me, and we put it in a new place in here. So the classroom where all the classes take place, we have a store in there. And then off to in front of me is a store. So behind us, we have a lot of things. We have a few things for Halloween up.
Woo!
And our crystal balls, they actually light up.
That's right.
But I don't know if that'll make a difference or not. So then, you know, with dragons, of course, we have our Indian sheep. We have our healing tools. We finally said, you know what? We probably should tell people about them. We have them in front of the table here as well as behind us. And I was thinking we have Sense of the Soul or we have Soul Sense.
Yes,
and
Sense
decided
your
my
soul.
Name. The name of the oil.
Right. We can sense your soul and so can you.
Or we can have Soul Sense once you get some.
Ding, ding, Clubus.
Oh. Clubus. So we haven't decided the name on that. But those are specifically designed and made. Now, the ones we have back there are the chakra
and chakra.
And then Om, and levels of love, and these balance.
Psychic punch?
Psychic punch. Oh my gosh.
No
yes.
punch bets.
There's a lot of people that come in to the shop, and one of the things that they do is they're like, well, they want to help with their psychic abilities. I have some people that are afraid of it. There's some people that closed it down. Some people have too much coming in at once. So the psychic punch actually balances and helps you to start creating a foundation that is necessary and moving forward. So then also the color are the chakra pillows. These are specifically designed shapes. It can be any shape. But what's inside is the stones, the copper, all of this wonderful stuff that has different properties, and it'll help. And the color helps as well. And they're based on the chakras, but you can use them anywhere and at all times. Sleep with them if you must. Then, of course, you know, pendulums, treasure chesting. My soulpathics, they're huge because the soulpathics are specifically designed for you. They start with an organ base. So if a liver
Oh, not that organ.
No. If it's a liver issue, then it'll show up as that's the level that I have to look at. Then I break down and find out what part of the liver it needs attention. And then usually you will always find a thought pattern, a memory muscle or something. And so then I have all of these wonderful, beautiful tools.
Taking a soulpathic, I can't remember what organ we're working on.
I don't remember either. You got a billion of them we're always working on.
Right.
But anyways, all of these wonderful tools here, from flower essences to oils to rocks, that help and has a certain property and priority. Because we teach about what life represents. And that is specifically designed then to match your frequency or even the frequency of the signature that you have to heal out of your life. Then if there's a certain...
Emotional issues.
If there's a certain pattern of personality, of behavior, or attitude issue, and you don't really think it's an issue anymore, but it no longer serves you, it can become a problem. So,
well, what's interesting is, for example, people still... So I grew up being punk. I know I've talked about this on the show before.
But that's good.
And so that served me at that point, mostly my teenage years. I'm not a teenager anymore, but my friends who knew me at that time, that I'm still friends with from time to time, will want me to fall back into that pattern. Or they react to me as if I'm going to react in that way. But that's not who I'm developing myself to be right now. As you know, I'm hovering around the age of 40.
Jen.
Come on, we know. What are you really thinking, Jen? Come on, we know you have things to say. And it's like,
who do you think you are?
Right, that's really not going to be serving me or the relationships that I'm fostering and nurturing right now. But it's sitting in my field because it was who I was at a certain point. So now it's time to just, you know, clean that kind of remnant.
If it sits in her field, what will happen is that she can be in her happy space, and anything remains in that foundation, if anything remains in that foundation, then the person that doesn't know you at this new one will then hook into that part that's still there and yank you down. And I mean yank you down, because vibrational wise you're in a different space than they are, and they want you to be at the level that they are.
Right, so they're not rising.
Not intentionally, they don't realize it.
It's completely unintentional, but they're not up at that frequency where I'm, you know, especially when I'm in my spirit, tuned in space, and it's just like, bing, bang, boom, this is, you know, I get this, they're yanking me down to where I used to
be. And here's the interesting thing. Again, it's not out of intention of hate. She just had two wonderful friends here just recently, and one of the things is that they were using guilt trips, and they were trying to prod her, but it was all about, oh, we love you, Jen, come on, be in our space, we miss you. And it's great, and it was a lot of love and support, and they're helping her feel that she's approved of and acknowledged and wanted her, but she's also in a different space, and the universe is saying, well, you need to clear this up over here, you have to do this here. And literally, she's like, I don't mean to disappoint my friends, but I know I can't just come out and directly say, I can't do this. Because then there would be all that, oh, why not? And then
you don't like us.
And then there's going
to
be the convincing.
We're not good enough for you. And I don't want them to go there. I don't want to go there. So it's about that respect.
Right. And so, again, we're not here to want to fight, we're not here to blame, but we're watching the patterns. And one of the biggest patterns was is that she has to create a healthy boundary to stand up within herself and say, I have to have the courage to say, this is the direction I'm going. This is who I like to be.
But I was always fighting for that acceptance.
Yes.
Always. And so then that's another temptation. If we're talking about spiritual temptations, that's another one of mine, is wanting that love and acceptance. I begged, borrowed, and stealed it for like a good part of my growing up. And now it's like they're feeding that part. It's like, oh, damn. It's like, I want that, but I...
We need to explain what do you mean by feeding that part. I mean, our soul needs nourishment, and then if it can't have the healthy nourishment, then all of a sudden it'll go back to be fed another way. And what else would we want to say about this? She drew a complete blank. Well, how do we nourish? And, you know, usually you think of food, but see, you are what you think, and you are what you become. So if she's emanating people to pull her down, look, you know, just constantly do what it needs to do, then that's the only kind of nourishment she knows, is like eating a candy bar. Some people say candy bars are bad. Well, let me tell you, you change your frequency on it, and then chocolate actually helps. Dark chocolate's even better, because it has a frequency of its own. So she can only nourish herself with the only stuff that she has applied, what's available. A lot of people will say to me, well, I'm just tired of my old friends. I want something more. And they're always looking for that approval from Tom, Dick, and Harry that are negative and nasty. And it's because it's the signature of how you know. And you can run, you can fight, you can stand up, you can grow. But eventually, you got to wonder why you're trying to make friends out of your enemies. And why you got to keep your enemies around. Why you're looking for their approval, your enemies' approval. When are you going to consider the source? When are you going to go, wait a minute, I can actually decide I don't need these people. When I heal the relationship with this man and this woman that was attacking me, trying to take my kids, were just mean, they hated me, they wanted my life, they wanted my house, they wanted my in-laws, and it was like, why? Well, that was the signature I grew up with. And when I finally started healing all these little tiny things like territory issues to why people don't like me, to finally deciding that I'm going to change the energy cord. And when I healed that out, the universe took care of it. And the next thing you know, they were spun out of my life. And it was like, whoa. And I didn't have to try to, because they're always in my space. It was like they had to be family. No, I don't have to. And even when I stopped talking and I didn't talk to them anymore, it didn't matter. They were there. They were in my space. And I had no choice. It was like I was forced to, just like it was when I was a kid growing up. But literally, when I changed that signature, that entanglement cord to that signature, they left. And it made room for me to allow like-minded peeps in. And when you have like-minded peeps in, you don't even have to look for their approval. Because, like, me and her, okay, we're going to do the set redesign. And the next thing you know, I did the same thing. She was over there doing the thing that I had thought of, what I wanted done. And it started to work, and then
it was like, yeah, I came, you know, we have a kind of routine and meet up, okay, so what are we doing tonight? Oh, we're doing this? Okay, what do you need me to do? Okay, I'm going to fit in, I'm going to be in the little cog in this wheel over here and doing da-da-da-da-da-da, and we didn't even have to...
No, there was a lot of times we weren't talking, but it wasn't because we didn't have anything to say. We were completely focused, and not wondering, oh, is she mad at me? No, there was none of that, because we were in sync and rhythm, and... what we're going to do, and so this is what we
just
came up with.
Mm-hmm. To be together.
Yeah, we didn't disturb anybody. Thank God, because they're all in bed.
I'm like, yeah, you want to hammer some nails? Oh, right. 2:00 in the morning.
So, one of the things that we're going to be doing is doing the interviewing process. And I've got 2 telesummits coming up, and one of the things they say is, give you your bio, and then how would you want to be interviewed? And I'm like, wow. So this has been mulling over in my mind, and I actually have to get the information to these people. And to the point where I got up at 6, well, I didn't go to bed. And so I got my little handheld recorder, and I realized it's the progression of who you were to where you come. You know, where are you now? Why are you here?
What is this thing called life?
So my adventure to become a medicine woman, basically, who am I? Brenda Bates, medicine woman. I'm a soul coach. I am a type of person that is a resolution oriented. I'm ready for moving towards the future. One of the things that got me started on this path was simply, let's put it this way, my mother, see, there's so many things I want to say. I had so good in my head last night. Okay. I shut it off. I shut my abilities off. I thought that everybody had them, just like, you know, I thought you saw the way I saw. I thought you acted. Until I had this little old lady tell me, as I'm standing next to the casket, and everybody's mulling around mourning, and I'm 3 years old and not sure exactly what's going on, and they keep saying this person's dead. Well, I knew what dead was. How many animals on my farm died, you know? They're standing right there, and I would always point, and the person was standing in the corner and next to the casket, and then this little lady came up to me, and she was a real religious freak, and then she turned around, and she told me the devil's in me, and I'm a liar, and, you know, it scared me to the point where, like, what? And then I started to double think. Okay, so why is it I saw my mother and dad's divorce before it happened? Why did I see my father going to die? Why did I know that my mother was going to die? See, I didn't even think about these things as bad until that moment. And then all of a sudden it's like, well, I don't want to know any of this stuff. You know, I knew when my brother was going to die. I don't want to know this stuff. So I'd shut it down at 16 years old. I would say it was such a flash, but it was probably accumulation. I never really thought about time-wise. It could have been at least an hour's worth of flash-forwarding in the future. I was standing there talking to my friend, and all of a sudden I saw it. I saw my boyfriend, how he was going to pull up, how his car was going to act, the way it looked, the way it sounded, the questions that my other friend was going to ask me, the momentum of the vehicles, I knowing what direction that they were going to turn and drive, knowing what kind of accident was going to be, knowing the police siren, which direction it was going to come from, and then one guy coming back to my house is, you know, knowing that he's going to knock on my door and, you know, talk to me, and there's like, no way in hell I want to know the answer to this, because I already know the answer, I don't want to be told, and then all of a sudden it was just a flash, and then all of a sudden, I didn't even get to breathe, and it started to unfold. I'm like, seriously? And there was not a thing I could do. I was in complete slow motion. And I went through all of the steps, and that's when I just said, I don't want to know when people are going to die anymore, especially if I can't do a damn thing about it. This is before I learned about respecting the soul. I mean, this is to the point of how much I shut it off that I had a bitch slap in my own face, because you weren't meant to shut it off. But it was a journey that my soul did take, so guess what? It is all was intentional by myself. So and then I didn't turn it back on until my mother had cancer. Okay, fine. Why is there such cancers? Why? So then the questions started to come from my soul. Okay, I need to know now. And here in the Bible, because I read the Bible 3 times straight through, and I realized by the 3rd time around that as man's words disappeared, there was a whole other meaning, and they showed me like 3 or 4 meanings of layers that when the consciousness shifted, the Bible energy of it will shift too. And I was like, holy crap. So then what stood out was hands-on healing. Okay, fine. If there's hands-on healing, prove it to me. The next thing I know, I'm introduced to a faith healer, electromagnetic energy, muscle testing, herbs, acupuncture, and then the next thing I know, times and everything had to shift, you know, people had to die off. Then I ended up getting married and pregnant, and then I really had to face the fact that when people drive away, they're going to die. Oh my God, that was completely in my face. Being pregnant just enhanced it incredibly. So I said, I have to heal this. And so then I said, okay, I got to do something. Well, Reiki was introduced, and I go, there's my answer. The answer was, what is hands-on healing? And I then got attuned to Reiki 1, 2, 3, and Ascension Reiki. And then I've got 20 other healing modalities that I've been attuned to energy-wise. I've studied on, and it boils down to you and your thought and your soul. And it was everything that I couldn't understand, and then, oh, that's why I see that energy. Oh, that's why that's happening. Oh, that's what I'm looking at. And all the answers were just pouring out and in front of me, and I didn't want it to stop. And so then when my daughter got sick, because she got, they gave her a shot, inoculation shot, pretty much almost killed my daughter. And when I saw the miracle of watching my teacher say, "Dad, give it to me quickly," because my daughter was life and happy, and then all of a sudden she was completely dead in my arms. I mean, lifeless, and it's like she had a pulse, but I saw no life in her eyes. I'm like, I broke my baby. Oh my God! I'm like, I'm crying, and finally, when I took her to my the teacher, she says, "Give her here." And so then all of a sudden she put her hands on where the inoculant shot was, and then 20 minutes later, you could tell all the energies have shifted, and I thought, okay, I have to pay attention to what I'm really looking at. I said, thank you for the healing tools. And the next thing you know, all the healing tools that's been around for 20, 30 years have started pouring in. And I started learning a lot about hypnotherapy, subconscious mind, to neurolinguistic programming, to you name it. It just started to teach me, and it's just been unfolding ever since. So all of a sudden, it was, why is it I watch people walk around that they say they're positive and they're happy 1 second and then bitch the next? And then why does life and sickness always have to happen? And why did this bad stuff happen here? Why does this always happen to me? Then, because I asked those questions, everything else started to unfold to where I could saw and understood deeper about what I was really looking at. So I'm fine-tuning my skills. I'm like, oh my gosh, I have a job to do. I have to get out there and help people to actually realize that they couldn't process this moment. That they weren't given healing tools. What are we supposed to do? We're going to go a break. That is what we're going to do, and we'll come back and talk about it more. And now it is.
I'm sorry. I didn't realize it wasn't.
Oh, it's not your job. And who do we have with me? Do I hear another voice?
Who is that? Usually we hear them in our head and we don't really see them. But
this is your conscience speaking.
Yeah, well, my husband, Scott Bates, has joined us. He just got out of work. He gets home at about 5:20, and it was kind of neat to watch him because our dining room is our studio, and so in order to get to his office, he has to run. And so he came
duck or crawl, yeah.
Duck or crawl, or wait until we pause because we have a video camera, you know. This is cool. So glad to have you with us. Have you had a good day?
Glad to be here, yes.
Okay, good.
It's been a good Friday.
So, as far as interviewing me, what other questions would you think anybody else would have?
Okay, so you talked about what it was like growing up with your abilities, and you talked about the different teachers that you had and how you've nurtured and what you've learned. So, I think one of the biggest most popular questions is about, I get, do you tell the future? As a psychic medium, because we use that title, we throw that title around when referring to what we do, so what does that title mean for you being a psychic medium?
Okay, first of all, when it came to the label of psychic, there was a lot of bad connotations out there, and I never
realized.
Are you
airy fairy?
No. And the thing is that a psychic is a one that reads energy. I read energy. I also channel.
You see the unseen.
I see the unseen. Now, when people say to me, hey, you know, predict my future. No. Because you have 41 thoughts per minute, correct? That's 41 different ways that you can create your future. If you were to conscious on one versus the other intentionally, that changes your future. If you make a decision, it'll change the future. Now, I can look at the energy loss, the energy you have right now, and about how much is being used to all of those markers, those things that were thrown off your center and you couldn't process. Well, I can easily start to read those. And they show up in the order that your soul wants them to heal. Okay? So that people say, well, if I healed that, then there's none left. Why didn't you see them all? Well, excuse me, your soul works on giving you layers, and so you can only see certain matrices or webs at one time. You can kind of see sometimes when they link back and how they're hooked, but really you need to focus on this particular thing. So if I look, I can actually then see how you're going to create your future based on how your programs are. And And a lot of people, it's usually not about, oh, will I get married? Oh, yes, I see it. No, I will look and I'll say, you know what? How you do anything is how you do everything. You have an issue with men. You have an issue. You know, I can literally look at the projections of what's going on and help you understand that, if you want a relationship, have one. Okay? This lady, she's never been married, and she's never had a date, and she asked me if she was going to, going to get married, and I looked, I says, yes, everything is possible. It's a probable. It can. But these are the things that's stopping you from why you have not had a date yet, why you haven't been, in here with people. Sometimes it's not even a problem. It's the way you're unfolding. It's the way you have to learn. If you want it, then start taking the intention. And so then I was doing a walkthrough, which is called a future pace. And so as I'm walking her through the future pace about bringing this man in, we didn't even get really close to stepping outside her door. Oh my God, I'm not ready to talk to him. I said, oh. Okay, why? And then she had all the knowing. She told me why. These are all these logical, illogical, and excuses that sit in the caught-up nucleus. And I says, all right, let's start picking them off one by one. Instead of just letting them go, or you forget them, or however you do it, let's bring to the surface, let's tap it out, resolve it, and have closure to it so that you can get one step closer to going out on this date, to getting married. So we had an interesting show one time where this lady, two people actually, says, am I pregnant? Okay, one, yeah, we're like, well, it's totally possible that you want to be. And then I says, but you want to be for the wrong reasons. I says, but the baby is not there yet. The soul is hanging around waiting, but it hasn't come to fruition yet. So what is your intention with this man? And she goes, no, I just wanted a yes and no answer. I said, well, if you think this way, then yes, you will.
But there's more involved than yes and no, mm-hmm, when you're talking about pregnancy, other than obviously the action of you're a little bit pregnant or you're not. But
exactly. And here's the thing. When you are looking and addressing the issues or the energies, one of the things is that it depends on how close it is to the body. It starts out in the spiritual bodies and starts to move in. And once it hits in the physical, then it's more permanent. It becomes more chronic. It becomes more reality. Well, her issue of where she was pregnant, it was just floating in the spiritual part, which said it's a probability, maybe so, but then there's interference of the mental body and the emotional body, and then the issues of things that she hasn't resolved. And, so was it? Is she? And we come to find out she just missed her period, and all of a sudden she's like, she just had sex, just missed her period, and oh my God, I'm pregnant. It's like, no, she wanted to be with this guy. So there was a whole another realm to it. And I can't remember what the second one was about pregnancy, but she goes, oh my God, you're right about that too. So it's not that about we're right. It's about the vibration of what it's telling us.
Right, and the biggest way to predict your future is to look at your past.
Exactly. And so as far as predicting that future, no. And the other question we always seem to have, what are they thinking? It's their fault. Tell me, are they going to choose me? Do you love me? Does that person going to be in my world? And it's not even about them. It's about all of what they see. Will I get that job? Will I do this? And it's, again, this is a trigger explosion, because when I go back, I have to follow all of those thought patterns, all those different variable waves above your head. Because the first time that somebody asked me to predict the future, I looked above their head and there was thousands of variables. And then as soon as they changed their thought, it changed the web, the spider web changed again, and it kept changing. And I'm like, okay, I can't do that. I got to find another way to communicate with this soul about what it is about this future. And that's what it boiled down to, was look at this, because all this is a projection. Your inner world creates your outer world. And so I had to look at what we're projecting. What are you doing? So I found a way to communicate. And then to not only did I only communicate, but I learned to teach others how to do it. You can choose to have a happier, wonderful life, because suffering is an option. And we're looking at all of the things that make up who you are by based on how you know, and some of those things just don't fit, some of the templates. Like when I was helping Jen, when her joking where it was cutting. What do I mean by that?
My sarcasm had a bite to it.
Yeah.
And gosh, it's been 3 or 4 years since you first brought my attention to the fact that people were being hurt by what I was saying.
And it was interesting because that person wasn't, that person wasn't, but that person was, because they were like, oh my God, she's talking to me. And so then I thought, that's interesting. So it's not a flaw. You understand. She knew it wasn't. I said, oh, this particular thing that your energy is doing, do you want your, by coming in the room, you need to own what your space of your energy is. And I said, so did your intention is to cut certain people? And she said, no. And then she said, well, yeah, to some degree, because when she first started doing it, was to protect herself.
Right. I had to have that little porcupine protection layer, because I knew that that person were going to throw daggers, were going to do things to me, and it was like, screw them before they fuck me over. Sorry, pardon the language. Sorry.
That's okay.
But that's how I lived my life for a great number of years.
And so then she mellowed out as she got older, but the thing is that energy in that foundation still sat there, and I said, it's actually becoming a limitation within you, and we're going to preserve all the positive learnings, meaning she can take all of the reasons why she had to create it to protect herself. Now let's just take the dross and get it out of you. File it away. Take the floaters and flush them down. Get rid of what we don't need.
Love that analogy.
I do.
Because we were talking the other day, you're like, why was I even thinking about this? I'm like, because you've healed so much, the energy is so light that when an issue comes up, it's like something's floating to the top, and you're like, oh, like a floater. I'm like, oh my, honestly.
Well,
that's not what I meant.
And we found a new one, Scott, because she says, well, we're going to heal where the fan gets shut off so that shit don't have to hit the fan.
When shit's going to hit the fan so that it's less messy.
Yeah, so it's less messy. Oh, so don't get me started, because I have a tendency to run with certain things.
Right.
Yeah. <you know.
laughs>
That's why I'm such
no
a good
tangents
influence.
Here.
But it is very important to understand that you get to decide what do you want about your life. If you don't like certain things, or, you know, like some people really use it because that is the only way they know how to process an emotion. Like, we have this one friend that we have, and this person had just got divorced, and they're still hurt, and they're still burned, and they're still angry. That their inner world creates this outer world where they're constantly being attacked by the ex-husband, or all of a sudden there's people that just call you a whore, or just nasty stuff. And it's like, we want to reach out to her and say, okay, how about if we take this moment and that you couldn't process and actually heal it to the point where you can process this.
Right, there's still that porcupine layer.
But at this point, we know that she still has to use it. She still has. And this is all just a cover-up to some degree, because the real reason what she needs to heal, she doesn't want to even look at yet. And so then it's an unfoldment. So we just keep sending her light and love. Again, we're not looking at it as to blame. We're not looking at it to say it's wrong. We're sitting there going, wow,
you're losing power.
You're
losing a lot of power to this.
She even wrote us and says, do I seem angry? Yes, you do. This is why. Would you like to heal it? No, then I'll keep it. Oh, okay. And you have a choice.
Okay,
that's your free will.
We're your sounding board, and here's the reflection back.
And, you know, why did she come to me? Because she knows I'm going to tell it like it is. Not in the sense of the human nature of the ego going, I'm going to tell you the truth. And most of the time when people tell you the truth, it's their truth. It's their pain. It's their definition. And it's just their truth until they learn to grow out of that truth, which means they're going from a baby to the teacher, or student to the teacher to the guru. They're learning their growth of what truth is. So sometimes it's only irrelevant to that person. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to take a small break, and we'll be back after this. We're back. Okay, so you learned a lot about me. And what now we need to do is interview Jen. Hi, Jen. How are you?
I'm great.
And so who is this amazing Jen?
Okay, so I'm going to follow some of the template that you started with, and maybe I'll put my blog information in the chat room. I'm on angelheartofit.com, and I've got a blog, and I've been actually talking about looking at how my ability started and that kind of thing, and the different aspects of who makes me me. So let's see. I remember I was a toddler, preschool age, the first time I remember actually having a vision into another world. And I thought, and I didn't have anybody to talk to about it. I didn't understand what was going on. I was just learning how to talk, let alone talk about, like, hey, did you see that? That there was, like, this thing in the sky, and it opened up. I knew on some level I was not supposed to talk about that.
Yes, it's like you saying, I really seen Santa Claus. It's right. Crazy.
Yeah. So I knew I wasn't supposed to talk about that, and so if I had anything as far as visions and seeing the other side or anything like that, and we've muscle tested, we've accessed my subconscious as to that little toddler part of me. I grew up, well, now I'm kind of skipping all over the place, born in Southern California, grew up in Washington, D.C. My dad was minister at a Swedenborgian church, Church of the Holy City in Washington, D.C., that was my world for most of my growing up years. And it's this old Gothic church, seats 500 people, stained glass windows, but dark. Dark.
Is that why you didn't go goth? You just put punk?
Yes.
I've never done that.
I was punk became before goth. But anyway,
oh, yeah.
that's
goth,
a different
sorry.
Tangent. Maybe I'll blog about it. Okay. So anyway, so we went into, we would go to the, and so this building had been there since the turn of last century, at least, you know, based on the architectures. There were all those spirits hanging around. If I saw anything, and we've, like I said, so we accessed that, yes, I did have visions. I did see what was going on. My dad would always talk about, well, I got to go to the church in the daytime because of the ghosts. So there was the ghost that was in the organ, and there was the ghost that was in the church office. And it's like, you know, we got to run and go do this stuff and then come back downstairs and get out because, you know, because my dad didn't want to interact with the ghosts. So, anyway, but I was seeing that kind of stuff.
Excuse me, it's not ghosts.
Oh, they're not.
Apparition Americans.
Oh,
okay,
that's right. We
want to
be
go.
Affirmative of who and what they are. So, in the PC language. So, I had to shove that down. Don't talk about it. Don't acknowledge that this is part of who I am, what I'm about, that kind of thing. But my dream life was something that I couldn't control. I, you know, during waking hours, I knew that I wasn't going to talk about it, but my dream life really had a life of its own, and I had nightmares, night terrors. I did not want to go to sleep. There were really monsters under my bed, and nobody to talk to about them at all, and so, but I learned that I had an overactive imagination. I would want comfort. I would wake up in the middle of the night, go to mommy's room, and she said, oh, it's just your overactive imagination. Go back to bed. Oh, it's just your overactive imagination. So I'm like, okay, I'm not going to have an imagination. If this is what she's telling me, then I'm going to cut this out. I'm not going to have an imagination anymore because that's bad. So there were different parts that I knew I wasn't supposed to talk about, dream about, be about, and just turn it off and just not acknowledge that that was part of my world at all. I got to the point where, but I knew this was going on. I still knew, and I would be going to summer camp each year from the time I was five. There's a retreat center here in Michigan, and I don't want to give it bad press or people think about it negatively, but the veil is really thin, and some people may say, oh, that's really cool. The veil is really thin between both worlds, and everybody that goes there knows it on some level. Well, when I was, the summer that I turned 17 was kind of a turning point for me in many different ways, and I had this horrific experience, experiencing different dimensions. I still didn't have anybody to talk to. We were playing Capture the Flag over in the churchyard, and I twisted my ankle, so I had to stop playing, so I just kind of, was kind of waiting out. I went over to the dorm, because it was going to be our bedtime soon, and the way that the dorm is, there's this wall of windows, and all the windows were open, and it was a really windy night. It was a dark and stormy night. No, it was windy, and it was, all the energy was pushing against the door, so that when I opened the door, I had to, it's a very light door, I had to force my way into the dorm. It was the weirdest thing. And normally, we, as teen girls, we would leave the lights on, like, all the time. That was the night that we did. It was really weird. So I turned on the light, closed the door, and I was waiting for other people to enter into that space with me. So they did, and we all entered in. And then all of a sudden, It felt like there was this tornado of energy that came in through the fire door, went in through the bathroom, back out the door, and left. I fell to the floor, screaming my head off, and it was like all of a sudden like Alice in Wonderland. And I didn't, and so I was having these kinds of experiences. I looked at my best friend and said, I don't know what's going on, but I knew I couldn't stay in the dorm that night. I had to sleep somewhere else, make excuses, do something. And I tried to talk to people about it. I talked to our youth minister and said, hey, I had this really weird experience, and I feel like there was this stuff going on. He's like, oh, okay, that's really interesting. I'm like, the hell are you? Really? Really? You're not even, can you find somebody for me to talk to about this? I had shoved it down, so I just knew. And so I also was having all kinds of emotional stuff in my family life going on. And then when I got back home, fast forward a little bit, that was the time period in my life where I attempted suicide. Because I knew that waking up every single day meant that I was going to experience pain. Whether it was from the other side, whether it was from my emotional life, my mental life, whatever, I had completely cracked. And I was just done. I was done experiencing waking up to pain every single day of my life. And luckily, I didn't exit the planet at that point in time.
Yes, amen.
And I got a ton of help. And from that experience, a lot of good things happened. And I was able to kind of reformat the relationship with my mom and my the people in my life. And then what's interesting after that, then my mom and I started going to Whole Life Expos. I'd have to probably look at it more, but it was really this really interesting turnaround in my life where we started going to Whole Life Expos and really engaging other realms. And it was kind of like, almost like, well, you're 18 now, let's talk about this. I don't know if that had anything to do with it. But it was really cool, and we'd get aura pictures taken, and I got this really cool, my tarot deck, very creative person that developed the Voyager tarot deck, and then we started going to chakra reading classes, and then I realized that I was right on. I'd be reading people's chakras, and I'd be talking about, like, these 40, 50-year-old people, and I'd be talking about their childhood home, you know, hundreds of miles away. They're like, there's no way that you could know that. You weren't even alive when I was there. They just affirmed that I had abilities. And so I started waking up those abilities. But then the way that my life, the chapters in my life, I had that little experience in my world. And then I went off to college. I went off to acting school. I went off to college. I started looking at being a witch because it seemed like that was the world that I was supposed to be part of based on the abilities that I had. And so, hence I got my little tattoo and that kind of thing.
Tattoo?
Yeah, I have a little witch tattoo. So,
you know, could you show it for the camera?
I don't think so.
Maybe if I was wearing a different shirt.
And with a little cauldron with it. See, Ray.
Right there.
See?
The
witch.
A little further.
Ooh,
you're really real! You're really going to have to watch the YouTube on this, people in the chat room. No, so I got my little cauldron, and it's a Chinese symbol for witch, and I have my little familiar paw prints. So I decided, hey, maybe this is who I am, because...
Maybe I'll take a picture and we'll post it.
That's awesome. So...
Yeah, medicine woman
revealed.
Okay, so, but that seemed like that was the world that made sense. If I have these talents, gifts, and abilities, that's what I'm supposed to do. But that still didn't make sense for me on some level. And I'm not condemning, I'm not putting down, I'm just saying it wasn't for me. There are aspects of that I play around in as far as those gifts, you know, witch and that kind of thing.
Here's the question, is that when we're looking at it, is that this stuff is already on the planet. And the new error is to take bits and pieces of all the things that you were. She was a medicine woman, she was a witch, she was a wise woman, she was
this, that, and the other. And she doesn't have to plug herself back into what is labeled in the connotation, but she has to create a whole new aspect of herself because of that she has a foundation on these.
And it felt, and I don't want to pigeonhole or limit myself in any way.
And none of them are bad.
Right.
It's just that that's not just her. She's more to her. She's grown.
Just this. Right. So then fast forward to the point in my life where I decided to go to seminary, answer the call to ministry.
Ooh.
Yeah. So I have a Master of Divinity from Pacific School of Religion in Berkeley, California. And I am ordained in the Swedenborgian Church of North America. And so...
Now, we know what religion is to some degree. We know what about being ordained is. But that magical word, Swedenborg, that's not Catholic. That's not Lutheran. That's not Baptist.
That's not Methodist.
Presbyterian. Wait a minute. I all those big high religions are out there, but Swedenborg's been around how many years?
He was in the 18th century when he wrote, put together his theological writings.
So now tell us a little bit about that.
Right. So this is the church that I grew up in, and my lineage on my father's side goes back to almost the beginning, the early 1800s. Our relative that was a professor at Tübingen University in Germany.
So it's been around for a long time.
He came across it, and from that point on, the Tafels have been associated with the religion.
But there's a lot of famous people.
William Blake was one of the first people. They had a reading group that in London. That's where Swedenborg's books were published, were between Amsterdam and London, and so there was a little advertisement, hey, we're going to meet here for a reading, and all kinds of people, I mean, the founding fathers of our country